Bluebird 851, turn right, heading 180. Papa, turn right 245, report localizer established.
Before I do begin this video, there's been a lot of confusion about this series. A lot of people have been commenting saying, oh, you're making up stories, clickbaiting the titles, and then I'm covering old news. I am covering old news. As I've mentioned in every single video, this is a recap series. So I'm recapping the year that was, 2018. I'm going to be covering the best stories from every single month, or the most major ones. I've already done January and February, and this is now March. So the first things you see at the start of the title will be included in this video and did happen during the month of March. I hope that clears some things up. Anyway, let's roll onto the video. Hey everyone, welcome back to DJ's Aviation and to the third recap of the year that was. This time the focus is on March. As expected, I've covered January and February. Those were both uploaded a few days ago. There'll be a card in the top right directing you to earlier videos should you want to know more about those particular months. We begin with Lufthansa, an airline which is featured in every episode of this recap series so far. Lufthansa announced their new livery only a month prior to their next major announcement, and many within the industry labelled it as quite embarrassing. During their European tour, conditions were less than favourable, and this resulted in lighting being extremely poor on the 747 and A321. Of course, in turn, this was not showcasing the livery how Lufthansa would have wanted. However, the airline quickly realised that the shade that they had chosen was far too dark, and they decided to go with a lighter shade, which meant that the aircraft that were just repainted headed back to the paint shop to get a revised livery painted on. At the beginning of the month, the White House signed a deal for 2 747-8s. The deal was one that caused a bit of controversy, as most things do, when the political side of things creeps into the aviation industry. Donald Trump negotiated a deal worth $3.9 billion. This deal was reported in May to be saving taxpayers around $1.4 billion again. Trump tweeted all the way back in 2016 his disappointment in the 747 program and essentially how high it would cost to purchase them. However, it does appear that through negotiations, the price was brought down drastically. It's important to remember that while you can pay a base price, say that $3.9 billion for the two aircraft, Air Force One sees nearly $5 billion spent additionally on just safety upgrades to keep the aircraft running. At the beginning of the month, Icelandair also welcomed in their first 737 MAX. The airline is set to use the 737 MAX for transatlantic operations, a market which Icelandair have spent a lot of time working on. Icelandair have ordered 16 of the aircraft, and this order was placed back in 2013. They intend to take them on through the coming years. The president and CEO of Icelandair commented on the delivery at the ceremony, saying, "The arrival of the new aircraft represents a milestone, the start of the renewal of our fleet, which is an exciting undertaking for Icelandair." Adding, "The MAX will be an excellent addition to our 757 and 767 fleet, and increase both flexibility and capacity for the growth of our network, through added frequencies and new destinations." United Airlines during the month publicly discussed their interest in Boeing's NMA, and also Airbus's A330neo, purely for fleet replacement. The American-based carrier has a very complex fleet at the moment, and is looking to trim down the variants that it flies. While no decision has been made as of December 2018, the airline has noted that its 767s and 757s, of which it has a combined 130, need to be replaced sooner rather than later. This has been a concern with Boeing's NMA. Will it release quick enough for airlines to actually order it and replace their older aircraft? United noted in a presentation to the media that they target a 25-year lifespan for their aircraft, and their 767s and also 757s are rapidly approaching that. Staying on the topic of the Boeing 767, Boeing during March shut down reports that it would be reviving its 767 to act as an NMA, or new middle of the market airliner, for customers. The Vice President of Commercial Marketing said, "Bringing back the 767 passenger version, I just don't see it." The idea behind reviving production of the 767 was to give customers an aircraft that would be cheap in the meantime while they'd be waiting for their NMA to launch. If Boeing saw delays with their NMA project, or it just actually didn't launch, this aircraft would be a perfect option according to many. However, Boeing did shut that down. March saw finally Virgin Atlantic cancel their long-standing order for 6 A380s, which had been continuously pushed back over the years. In fact, the first A380 was actually supposed to be delivered to Virgin Atlantic in 2006, However, the airline continued to push back deliveries and instead ordered the likes of the Boeing 787 and Airbus A350-1000. It has taken delivery of the 787 already and is awaiting its first A350-1000. The order for the A350-1000, according to many, was the nail in the coffin on their A380 order, which was signed for in 2001. This made Virgin Atlantic one of the earliest A380 customers out there. The airline said in a formal statement, "Following a thorough review of our fleet, we've taken the decision not to pursue our order for 6 Airbus A380s. Meanwhile, Cathay Pacific saw their first A350-1000 roll out of the paint shop in Toulouse. The airline will welcome 20 A350-1000s in the future. The rollout marked an exciting time for the airline, who will see A321neos, A350-900s, and 777-9Xs join up to modernise their fleet in the coming years." In the official statement, Cathay Pacific said, "The efficient A350-1000 will form an important part of our long-haul operations, and will be deployed on our new route to Washington, D.C. starting in September. The service to Dulles International Airport will become the longest on the Cathay Pacific network." Asiana Airlines during the month converted their remaining orders for the A350-800, which of course was a cancelled variant in the A350 series. The decision to convert the order was a long time coming, and was actually in fact the final order still standing for the scrapped variant. Other customer Hawaiian Airlines had moved to the A330-800neo before, a month earlier, switching to the 787-9. While no variant for Asiana Airlines conversion had been listed before the announcement, as expected, the A350-900 and the A330-800neo were heavily rumoured to be an option for the airline. During the month, we saw Turkish Airlines commit to 60 new aircraft, and also production drastically slowed on the Airbus A380, resulting in the European aircraft manufacturer cutting a number of jobs. March had us see another major incident with a US Bangla Airlines Q400 going down in Nepal. The flight departed on the 12th of March with 67 passengers and 4 crew on board. 52 people died during the accident, while 19 people survived. The cause of the crash was listed as a possible pilot error and also a runway alignment error. The two pilots had moments of confusion and also conflicting communications with air traffic controllers. Essentially, the pilots were unsure of what runway to land on despite being given instructions by the air traffic controllers. We saw the GE9X, the engine which is said to be on the 777X series, during March also complete its first flight. The engine is the successor to the powerful GE90 and has become known for its incredible size, after it featured on one of General Electric's 747 testbed aircraft. The month, though, was clouded by troubles within the industry. Cathay Pacific reported a HK 1.45 billion loss, a sum which would later become normal for the industry, with fuel costs continuing to rise at rates that meant some carriers could simply no longer cope. Pratt & Whitney, Airbus and Indigo were forced to ground 11 A320neos, which were experiencing issues. Pilots on board an Indigo A320neo flight reported that they experienced a shutdown mid-flight with one of the engines. This in turn prompted the aircraft to be grounded. Meanwhile, over at Virgin Atlantic, they were beginning to face major troubles with their 787s, which of course have the Trent 1000 engines attached. We saw many pictures emerge of Virgin Atlantic 787s parked up at various airports with their engines taken off or covered. As the month came to a close, we saw Qantas inaugurate the Perth to London service. To this day, load factors have been over 90%, and CEO Alan Joyce has reported that the route has been a huge success for the carrier. The first parts of the ANA A380 also arrived at the final assembly line. This was an exciting time for ANA, who will see their A380s placed on a Narita to Honolulu service. Over at Boeing, the manufacturer released its first pictures of the Boeing 777X in assembly. This is a big move for a new aircraft, as it's set to fly for the first time in early 2019. During March, JetBlue confirmed their interest in the C series, as it was known at the time. It's now known as A220. They confirmed that they were eyeing the aircraft for future expansion and also fleet replacement. The interest would later turn into orders from the American carrier after the C-Series was rebranded to the Airbus A220 series a few months down the line. Spurred on by interest from Amazon, Airbus during March and throughout this year have been eyeing an A330neo freighter, which would replace their current A330F model. Discussions have been ongoing, but the recent introduction of the A330P2F, or A330 passenger to freighter conversion aircraft, has meant that the likelihood of seeing an A330neo freighter in the coming years has definitely decreased. If Airbus was to launch the aircraft though, it'd go up against the 767-300F, and hopefully further boost the sales of the Neo upgrade. And that was March for you. Of course, I left out some stories, simply there is too much to cover, and I don't want this video going to 30 minutes, 25 minutes, as not only would that be tedious for you to sit through, but it'd be pretty tedious for me to edit, as these videos almost take a day to edit as it is. If you did enjoy this video, feel free to drop it a like and subscribe to the channel if you are new to see future episodes in the 2018 Aviation Recap series. I do very much look forward to you all joining me in the next one.